We really appreciate you spending the time, and that I guess our focus is on the arts community, and as a candidate, incumbent, we'd like to know, you know, some of the thoughts you have on helping and nurturing the arts community, particularly in the Northwest Territories and specifically Yellowknife. And we've been working on this arts community center project for quite a while, and that at the moment we've got this the opportunity to apply an application for a multi-discipline activity to carry on, and we're looking basically to find support in continuing that forward and finding the resources necessary to render down what we've learned so far into developing a strategy for the future. Maybe that can help you with your thoughts.
Well, I think it's something that I've worked on for many years. I remember in the early 80s, I was a member of the Society for the Encouragement of Northern Talent, and I worked with the people on promoting music festivals and other locations around the North, growing out of the Folk on the Rocks Festival. And out of that, when I was mayor in my own hometown, we set up a music festival, and it's still going 20-some-odd years later. And right across the North, there are fabulous musical opportunities that have grown out of people making those things happen. And I think that's, you know, it's organic, it's got its own special thing. I feel that that's where, you know, I've spent a lot of my cultural time, music, not so much as a performer, but as a supporter of that. When I was chairman of the Aurora College Board, I was pushing for the development of a fine arts faculty at the Aurora College, because I think that's one thing that would pay back in many ways, to develop a faculty that could give a form and substance to people's work in the fine arts. So I still think that is something that can happen.
Excuse me, I just want to close the door because I have a little distraction. So. Sorry about that.
And to me, you know, arts has a sustainability of its own that in a culture and in an economy that is so important. There's so much that goes around what we do and how we express ourselves, various forms. That's absolutely essential to any culture. And I find in the Northwest Territories, even though perhaps our governments haven't put any money into it as much as in other places, there's still this enormous pent-up demand for it everywhere. Everywhere I go, but it's like that. And Yellowknife is, as the largest center in the North, has a big role to play in that, absolutely. And in Yellowknife, you see, you know, it has to be a point of focus for as you know, as our center, a point of focus for all culture. And you know, it has to work in that direction. It has to be very, you know, large for the whole Northwest Territories. Very sharing. That's absolutely essential, I think, for artistic growth here. Is that, and I think that's how I'd see, you know, many things progressing in the future. When it comes to, you know, I'm pretty impressed with the idea that you have albeit for only 2 months or 3 months, a lease on something that allows you to give some growth and life to what you want to do here. You just see it already, eh? It's just a magnet for so many people to come here, and in a variety of forms, you know, so you get a holistic approach to the art scene here by having your own center, by having, you know, the ability for people to do a whole bunch of different things. Absolutely right. There's a critical mass here that can be engendered through that. You know, we And out of that will come lots of economy. You know, there's lots of return to the rest of the economy when we're doing what you're doing. And so to promote it, I mean, I think that's outfits like CanNor, the federal economic development agency should take a role in this as well, because it's economics. It's always been the North art scene has been great economics. Always, it's provided people with sustainability. It's provided people with income that allows them to be themselves. And so I think that's, and I know CanNor has, it's funny, when they set that agency up, I didn't think much of it, but the people within it can see it quite quickly, how important it is that they talk about sustainability. Not large projects, but large projects exist on their own. You don't have to put a lot of time and effort into, developing a diamond mine. There's very large companies that are going to do that for you. They're going to promote that. They're going to create that around that, and it's possible. Whereas a little, proper funding into the arts scene here, where it's been starved for so long, would make a huge difference. Mm-hmm. It would, so I see that, and I would certainly encourage that through something like CanNor, where, there's $500,000 a year to invest in art, but that's $500,000 isn't there yet, isn't there right now. And if you tie that into with the territorial government, then encourage them at the next election to start pushing the arts agenda.
So do you have any suggestions how, because at the moment we're technically an ad hoc group, using old resource materials and some new ideas. Do you have any suggestions for how we might move forward and help stabilize our effort? Because we're trying to figure out, we had a month and a half of activity. We need to take that activity and render it down into some good documentation. And we're looking for ideas for how to stabilize ourselves.
I'd go to IDI and ask for a business, ask for some funds to do a business plan. I mean, that to me would be the, coming out of a group, if you have a group that wants to work together, you need to have a vision of where you want to go, and you have to develop a business plan, which can get you there, which can actually deliver you to where you want to go. And identifies all the things that have to be in there to make it happen.
Any thoughts on whether this organization might be not-for-profit or whether it might be a cooperative?
That's entirely up to you.
Well, I realize it's entirely up to us. We're looking for ideas for what are good, sustainable. I mean, my experience with not-for-profits, it can be very ephemeral, but then again, business can be very...
I think, I've seen marvelous success with some, well-organized not-for-profits, where they have definite plan, definite goals, definite direction. I mean, what did you see with Folk in the Rocks? I mean, what is that? What is that organization? Is that?
It's a not-for-profit.
Yeah, I mean, and it's into almost 30 years, and it continues to grow. And that's just a single event, not-for-profit, but it carries a lot of weight over time. So. I don't see a problem with a not-for-profit in a business plan. I mean, in a sense where you have a clear direction where you want to go. You want to create a facility that does this, that, and the other thing. This is how much it's going to take to do that. This is how we're going to do it. This is the people that are going to be involved. This is how we want to do this. And that kind of organization, which there is funding available to do that, it would give you that opportunity to get that done. I just see how, I'm sure there are people in the community that would be of great assistance in doing that.
What about on the federal level? Any suggestions what doors we should be knocking?
Well, I go back to that CanNor door. I mean, that's a door that's there. I've just been hearing the words, when I talk to the people that work in that organization, that they're saying the right words. Now, how would you,
What type of organization Is this a corporation?
It's an economic development agency.
Okay.
That's been, federal government pulled together a number of things, and they set up an independent economic development agency. And that's the federal government did. Now, they cut its funding back, so it's not, they cut $17 million out of a $44 million budget. But they still got the 30 or the 20, $28 million left.
Similar mandates as ITI, or?
More contribution orientated, you know, project contribution orientated.
And what kind of project should they generally?
Well, they're looking, they're just started. But as I say, what I'm hearing from when I talk to the people there is that they are starting to realize that it's not large project that is really required here, it's sustainability of different things that can create sustainability. And the art scene is one of them. I mean, the art scene is a great generator of business.
Dennis, how much does the NDP support Canada Council for the Arts? And
do you want to know our platform?
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, okay, well, let's, you know, well, I mean, Canada Council, we want to increase the funding to Canada Council because it supports lots of northern artists. I mean, Canada Council has a, you know, but Canada is a Nordic country.
What do you say to the Liberals' notion of doubling Canada Council for the Arts? And
great.
Is it realistic? Is it realistic? I mean,
well, sure it is, because not that much. It's not a. We're not talking about you know, money that's huge.
And two fighter jets.
Yeah, we're talking about the cost of you know, of not, you know, a few drones.
You sure?
Yeah.
Can you talk a little?
Well, but hear me out. And when you put money into art, Canada Council, where does that go?
In the local economy.
It goes into art galleries and centers, and
it goes into people's wages, and they buy food, and they spend, they pay taxes, and they create product, and so it's a real economic stimulator. They know that. They know that anytime you do things in the arts field, what you're doing is employing people, usually at not huge wages. Most of Canada Council supports people at, you know, at a living wage or a little better than that. But they're producing product. They're developing something that has value, that creates value. So to me it's a lead pipe cinch that if you invest in culture, it's going to come back to you.
How do they decide on a federal level how much to invest in the arts?
Well, like the cabinet sits down and, you know, you'll have each department that will present what it thinks is, you know, its work plan. And each cabinet minister will go through that work plan and decide what is it that politically they want to accomplish.
I'd like to see that work plan, that formula of what, you know.
Yeah, well, and then they will take that forward, I guess, through the cabinet, and then they will make some decisions about it, then it will go back to the department, they'll know how much money they have, and they'll start allocating it into various areas. And that'll create what's called the main estimates, which are a document that comes out in March that tells how, you know, the $240 billion is being spent. Mm-hmm. You know, in every category. That's basically how government, you know, sets its goals for a year. And then when you add the budget on top of that, that's the icing on the cake. So that's what the politicians decide is going to be added on to the main work of government, the extra items. And that's what's called the budget. I mean, it's funny, it's not really the budget. The budget is really the main estimates. It's the you know, the thing that we was brought out at the end of March is really the kind of the icing on the cake. It's a process. I mean, if you have somebody, strong minister who wants to promote the arts, then you put the arguments forward to get the money.
So what's Layton say, or what's it look like?
Well, we want to implement a tax averaging for artists and cultural workers, so that you can, you know, multi-year your you know, if you sell a painting 1 year for $50,000 and you don't sell anything the next year, you can level out your tax average. So that can help you that way directly. We want to see the increased funding for the Canada Council. Like, you know, I mean, the Liberals have that too. Great. You know, maybe we'll be in a coalition one of these days.
Do you guys state it as they do?
Oh yeah, it's in her. I've just taken the stuff out of the out of our platform. Yeah.
Yeah, because it was pretty fairly bold claim of them to say to double the Canada Council in 4 years.
Bah! It's cheap.
It's not
compared to everything else. It's nothing. Sorry, Dennis.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not like.
Don't do it.
I mean, one of the things that you know, most all the parties are talking about is improving the broadband service up here. Mm. You know, that's everybody says that has to happen. I mean, it's, you know, there's things that are not you know, questioned. They're just, you know, how much are you going to do? Who's going to be in charge? Who makes the profit off of it? Those are things that government has to decide too, which are different than the over. You know, might have an objective. Everybody has the objective. Let's double the Canada Council grants. Okay, well, who's going to get the money? Is it going to be the struggling artist, or is it going to end up in the hands of large organizations that already exist? So those are questions that, when you come to, what does Canada Council want to do with the extra money? Who gets it? Does it go to the you know, Vancouver Symphony, or does it come to Yellowknife? Those were maybe, you know, like Liberals saying it's doubling. Well, what does that mean? Who gets the money? And those are important questions to ask as well when you're talking to, you know, like broad platform items. Like, and we want to provide strong support for Northern Canadian performing arts, cultures, and creators. I mean, that's what we're saying. I mean, so we're talking about that already. But it's, you know, and I think it's safe to say that the NDP tends to want to support the little guy. We want to get the money into the hands of, we're not interested in putting it into as much into the hands of big people, because that's you know, our philosophy is about is spreading it more at a lower level. That's why things like the tax averaging is interesting, because what it does is it goes directly to individuals, and they may be very creative individuals that, you know, 1 year might make $200,000 and then the next year make nothing. And so then their tax, you know, by tax averaging, you might find that you're making nothing, you're going to get a nice fat $50,000 tax return. And for an artist, that's an understandable thing. You might make a movie 1 year and get some money out of it, and next year you might not. You might be in development work all year and not see a single cent. So, I mean, I think we thought that one out pretty well. And then, you know, we believe in public broadcasting, so we're very supportive of strengthening long-term stable funding for CBC and other public broadcasters. That's, you know, been NDP policy for, I don't know. What's exciting about this election is that we may actually get a bigger role for our policy rather than, you know, always being the ones that are, you know, trying to sell it from the opposition benches, which is a hard thing to do. So it's, you know, you have to work hard to sell an idea from the opposition bench. Not that we don't, but it's more work.
Dennis, one of the things that we've been talking about in this group for a while is because we have temporary access to this building for this Artist Run Center, and there's some talk about maybe moving the building. Apparently it's been moved before and is capable of being moved again. But there's no land. I mean, we don't have any land. And you know Yellowknife not got much land. But there is some federally owned land in town. There is acreage that is either not being used or being underused or certainly could be used very well for an artist run center. If the NDP gets into office and is it possible, would you support taking a look at the land that's available here, the federal land, the federally owned land here in town, and seeing if there's a portion of it, a part of it that can be traded for some other piece of land, or somehow get put into the hands of the artistic community so that there is space to start that kind of project of an artist run center? It'd
be nice to have it downtown, though. Because I just, you know, and I was talking to Matthew about this earlier, I mean, downtown Yellowknife needs to be revitalized. They asked that question, you know, and what revitalizes a downtown? How do we do this now? We've got all the shopping out in Box Town out there, which is okay, I mean, but I think they took a lot of the energy out of the downtown area. So maybe it is the cultural community is the one that can revitalize the downtown. We talked about the old miner's mess, you know, like, why are so many people on the street? Well, they used to sit in the miner's mess all day, and nurse a cup of coffee all day long. That used to be Yellowknife. We used to go in there, the big benches, big tables, all full length, and there'd be people sitting in there all day. They wouldn't be sitting on the streets. They'd be communicating with other people. They would be better behaved because they're, you know, in an environment that they respect. And we don't have that anymore. I always felt that was a real loss to the community when that big barn of a miner's mess closed down. I don't know, did you ever thought?
I just moved here less than a year ago.
Okay, but you know, like the downtown needs revitalization. It needs to have things happening here. So I would much prefer to see an art center downtown, right downtown, where you're creating something that's of use to people and that, you know, makes our downtown better.
Les was saying the post office would be a nice place.
Yeah, but this is a nice building. You know, it's a very beautiful building, obviously. I was just taken by it when I came in the other day, and I could see how much you could do with it and how useful it would be in Yellowknife right now for an extra theater, with the amount of...
Non-alkalized place, on, you know, because the performance places are what, bars? Otherwise you've got NAC, which is quite specific to scene production, and there's a heritage which is kind of out of the way and not really...
Yeah, I mean, I think a performing arts place, I mean, the alcohol, non-alcohol, as long as the main objective of it is a performing arts place. I mean, what you have is artists trying to perform in places that are not performing arts places, but drinking places. And that only works sometimes. Most of the time it doesn't work. You end up with, you know, an artist trying to play a song and nobody's listening because there's just, you know.
Everybody's talking.
So, I mean, it's, you know, that's you know, you need them both. You need both of them. I mean, you can't, you know, and an art center, I mean, we used to have, you know, the Cave was not a bad place. I mean, in the old, you know, that was kind of good atmosphere and created a lot of things. But obviously, you know, a business doesn't want that so much because they have so much overhead. They couldn't afford to keep that thing going. Whereas a nonprofit arts society will have a place where people can perform every day. You know, every evening. You know, what you just need to do is have this business plan that outlines how you're going to pay for it and how you're going to get the dollars in place to keep the center open and provide some kind of, you know, direction to it and all the rest of that. And for a city of 20,000 people, it's entirely possible. And there are, you know, and so I'd say that's where I'd go with this.
Question. I know, like, that the Yukon gets quite a bit of, like, in the past couple of years, I think they got like a $100,000 bonus of the funding for the arts. I don't know if you've talked about this.
No.
But, and you mentioned, you know, more support to Northern Canadian culture and arts, and how does that balance out across the territories?
Well, you've got a government you had an NDP government in the Yukon for many years that pumped a lot of money, that developed a budget around art, and it worked. And nobody's taken that away because they know it works. They know that it creates this huge tourism influx, that it's all about their economy. It's an important and integral part of their economy. Whereas here we treat arts and culture as, you know.
Yeah, because they don't need it for.
Yeah.
Well, I think, Dennis, by the time that the UConn got involved with the arts was at a point in time when tourism and arts and culture was really about the only economic development that was going in the UConn, because all the mines had shut down.
Well, but
I think that was a real driving factor to us. You know, we've got to do something to keep people here in town. And I think that's one thing that the NWT has not really recognized yet, that arts and culture has a great potential for economic development. I mean, well, I know when I'm off on holidays, I don't go looking for a mine tour. I mean, I go looking to see the local, what's going on in the local arts and culture scene. And I think that's one thing that the NWT really needs to recognize, is that there is a very vibrant arts and cultural scene in the NWT and needs to be supported. And probably, you know, if you give $100,000 to the arts, you'll probably get $500,000 back in return.
But to the question of even direct responsibility, though, most of this stuff has to be done by the territorial and municipal governments, and it's very little what the federal government can actually do to assure these kind of things of happening. We have an election coming up here within the next few months to elect our new territorial government. Then that would be more the proper time to be talking about.
No, I disagree with you on that, because there's a lot of federal funding. The Canada Council for the Arts is a prime one. They have had a much larger budget than they do right now. And any sort of kind of artist in Canada has a whole bunch of different funds that you can apply to for funding. Heritage Canada has a lot of money that's also available to artists. So there is federal funding. And a lot of times, I think there's Federal Economic Development Bank, I think, or not, I might have the right words and stuff like that. I don't think that you can just automatically cut off the concept of being the federal people being not much to contribute. They've got a lot to contribute, yes. And I know in the amount of time that I've been here in the North, what the NWT Arts Council, their budget has, I'm thinking, is probably quadrupled from what it was when, you know, 10 years ago. There is getting more, but when you consider, you know, $500,000 from $75,000, well, that's pretty good, but what's spent on a lot of other things.
Yeah, when you
is, you know, there's a lot of other things that could have just even more value.
Yeah, the Yukon's about $3 million.
Yeah.
That the Yukon government puts in. So and they got a smaller population too. Yeah. And less communities. And so the per capita expenditure in the Yukon probably maybe, you know, it's maybe an order of magnitude larger, like 10 times larger per capita than here. So that's, you know, that's something. And I think that, you know, that shows. I mean, that's a lot of difference. And, you know, when you put money into something, then another money shows up. It's just like, money makes more money. In everything you do in this world, there's always partnerships. So if you want to go to Canmore and get money, and you've got territorial money, you're going to get more. Everybody wants in, because, and that's the reality of that. So, I mean, you're right. You know, you got to talk about this sometimes, and the next territorial election, great. But in the meantime, I think you should take advantage of what is there with IEI to get your plans for your arts center going. Like, don't stop. You guys are going, you know, like, you know, go down there tomorrow and ask them to fund a business plan. You know, you'll get $20,000 or $30,000 out of them for sure. And then you can hire somebody to work with you to develop this business plan. There's all kinds of mines around Yellowknife that can do that for you. That can if you're an artist, you don't want to do it exactly yourself, or you don't want to, you know, and sometimes it's good to have a little bit of room around you so that everybody can put into somebody else, and then then you're not, you know, it's, it doesn't blow up on you as easily then.
Here's a, in the years I've been working on, with this Irish Wine Communion project in the not-for-profit sector, to keep working with it and moving it forward, it's very time-consuming. And so to hire a consultant to do a business plan is great, but someone's got to manage and supervise the consultant and work with the group, and that's exhausting and very demanding. And in the past, it's always required a volunteer. But after a while, those volunteers burn out, and then the whole art project comes to a stop again. And then just this recent time, you know, there was a lot of things that came together. We had a 2 months of resources to focus on, but you know, in order to keep it moving forward, we've just spent everything that we have in energy, and that we need to culminate it and, you know, rally the troops or something, because the team that's doing it at the moment, we're, you know, on the limit of our capacity, and our resources are, you know, finite.
Well, you have to get more people involved then. You know, I mean, that's, you have to reach out some more. I mean,
do you have any NDP player friends that might like to come and help us?
Well, I mean, it's...
You've got a large resource of people. That
well, maybe there. After the election's over.
Well, I am talking about after the election. Like,
yeah. I mean, I've just sort of been on this horse for 5 weeks. I'm still standing, but just barely.
Yes, I'm sure you're familiar with the burnout at the end of a campaign.
Well, you want to actually burn out on the last day, not the third last day. So I've still got a little bit in the tank. But
so have you guys ever thought about reaching out to local high schools and their art communities within inside there? So if you guys can get some volunteer bases out there?
Well, we've done a variety of things, but it's a matter of, I mean, just that we, you know, nothing happened since about 2000, well, little has happened since about 2005. Last fall, the Art Society did a symposium type thing and pulled, dusted everything off and got it cranked up again. And then over the winter, it sort of, it rises and falls with the tide.
I mean, maybe you need to do some human resource inventory. You know, so that you identify all the artists, you identify people that are interested in doing this.
Human resource inventory, that's a good one.
Dennis, talking about Ken Moore, the mandate that I've seen from it, the kind of projects I've seen come out of it, are really very business-oriented, so far, anyway.
Well, they're talking. I'm hearing the words from them, you know, that they recognize that sustainability is what they have to start approaching. And, you know, that they see it all. They see it once the agency started and they started think-tanking about what's going on up here, that, you know, they realize that they have to work on sustainability.
So I guess what I'm getting at is if you get into office and have an influence in Canmore, do you think it's possible to aid them in keeping their eyes open on the potential of the arts in all the territories and investing in that?
I will guarantee you that I will support you and work on that particular aspect with Canmore, because I just see them as being ready to do this, you know, if they just get the right push. You know,
I think Dennis is coming back to the, you have to think of a good business plan.
Yeah.
You have to have the business plan in place, saying what you want to do, what you want to do it for, and then you've got something to go to Canmore with and other funding agencies.
Yeah.
And some of the mines and things like that in the private sector to get money, and the foundations, all of whom can have money to donate to things.
Yeah.
But you have to have that business plan first.
Yeah, that's how I see it play out. I mean, it's, and you don't have to call it a business plan if you don't like that name, and if it doesn't fit perfectly with how you feel about what you're doing, you can pick, you know, another name, another way of looking at it. But it's basically the same thing, because you have to, just what you say, you have to have all the details worked out so that you have a direction to go in, that you know where you're gonna. What you're going to accomplish, and once you have that, I've gone through these a number of times successfully, business plans for small businesses, for other kinds of activities, and I find them to be very useful. And they really give you a focus, give you steps, give you resources, give you everything lined up, and Certainly, you know, you can't expect artists to do that themselves. They may work, but you know, you got to make a living too. You've got to.
If you were building a small organization that's going to have an annual budget initially of say $200,000 to $400,000 annually, to build a business plan for that, with working with professionals, you anticipate spending $20,000 to $40,000 to build a business plan. Is that about a reasonable account?
That's what they would probably agree to give you.
Well, in terms of practicality, what it normally works like.
I would think it would be, because Ines, you've been around, you're not coming from zero here. Mm-hmm. I mean, you've been in business for how many years?
20.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people around here probably have a lot of ideas and a lot of, once you get into it, you can do a business plan, you can go to the website and you can, you know, download a traditional business plan, or you might even find a traditional model for a non-profit art center. If you look hard enough on the internet, there's probably one around there somewhere that would, you know, that the information is there.
Google it.
Dennis, you were talking earlier about Aurora College and an arts faculty for them. What about the idea that's been kicked around for the last little while about a northern university and having a university level arts faculty on that? I know we're talking the NWT here, but that's really the whole north.
I'm one that says, and I kind of go with it, the idea that any sort of post-secondary institution here, we have to be very careful with, because, you know, I mean, the idea you put it in one place. Well, one place in the vast northern territories is only one place that's thousands of miles from every other place. So we have to create something that has more legs to it than that. You know, it can't. You know, we really can't. You know, there's some. I remember hearing the Governor General, the last Governor General, talk about this, and he says, "Oh, we have to have an institution where Northerners can go in the North and get their education." And I thought, "Well, yeah, that would be good, but there's, you know, like, so you're going to put it in Yellowknife, and then everybody's going to come from everywhere else. They're not going to be satisfied with that. They're not satisfied with that now. So we have to create an institution that has many facets to it in many locations."
So you want a portable?
A virtual university. University of Arctic is one that started, it's global, but we need to create it in our own territories, and it can be, you know, your art center could be part of a virtual fine arts department. You know, why not?
I mean, that's, I'll put you in there.
Yeah, I mean, why not? I mean, what's wrong with that? I mean,
distance education.
Yeah, distance education, but real facility, you know, real small facilities in many locations that are linked together, that share information, that share faculty, that share students. I mean, there's that. What's wrong with that model for us? Then all we have to do is build up the broadband, which everybody agrees we're supposed to be doing, so that we have great communication, and that we can, you know, and that any art center here should be a video conferencing center. It should be a number of things that are not available really readily to the public right now.
Skype?
Yeah.
Once you get
bigger bandwidth, then you could probably go to, you know, but you want to be able to share ideas, you want to be able to share teaching, you want to be able to share a whole bunch of things. And artists work on their own. I mean, you know, if you had a, whatever kind of art that you were dealing with, artists are very individual. So, I mean, it wouldn't matter if one was in a room over here and one was in a room, you know, 1,000 miles away. They could share their art, because their art is created by themselves to a great degree. They need to work together with other people, but they're, anyhow, I'm going to leave it at that.
That's great. I got some good notes there.
It's even concept sort of, you know, such a virtual one, but to have traveling faculty is, you know, instead of having it, say, a fine arts program in Inuvik or Fort Smith, Hay River, whatever, maybe it's based in a community, but instead of somebody having to go there for a full academic year to take six courses for maybe 2 months. One course is offered in Hay River, Fort Smith, Inuvik, Yellowknife, so that you can get your one course. It's for some people, that year, picking up and moving for a year or 2 years is too much. But they might be able to commit 2 months, a month, solid days going to school, to pick up a course.
Yeah. Well, and once again, you're there because that's that. But it could be that you would go to Tromsø, Norway, to take a course. Mm-hmm. You could go somewhere, you know, because that's it might be global. It might be, you know, circumpolar global. That's what the University of the Arctic wants to be. They want to be a. And to me, that's exciting. I mean, that opened. You know, why would we not open up rather than limit?
So you think the federal government could take a part in that? Internationally and
that's going on in Canada. You know, like we've got noted Canadian scholars that are telling us we have to have a bricks and mortar university in northern Canada. And our guys in the three northern colleges are saying, oh, we want to go virtual. We want, you know, so they're actually, you know, our people are saying this, and others are saying, no, we want to have this other kind of, you know, this is the only country in the world that doesn't have a northern university. Well, okay, you're right, but that doesn't mean we have to just be like everyone else.
Yeah, and of course, the bridges are good for some.
Yeah, but you know, you just, you know, have, I mean, what did we do in with our college system? You know, we weren't satisfied with one campus, two campuses, three campuses, then 23 learning centers. I mean, we just had to move it out to the communities. I mean, that's, you know, what we need with our college system is more interconnectivity.
Okay. One of the other things that I've really noticed working with the arts community is the loud cry about alternative education systems. The conventional system works for a lot of people. For myself, it didn't. And the apprenticeship program, the hands-on learning, the mentor-type program, totally worked for me. And the people just continually coming in the door here that are like magnets being drawn to steel for artistic development.
Yeah, I was just talking to a sculptor here yesterday who's got a place down now in Back Bay there. And they're like, everybody's just glomming onto his place. I mean, it's, you know, that's what happens here, right? That's, so he's got four or five guys working around him now already. But it's just because he has a facility here. So if you have a facility here, they'll come.
I bet you're pressed for time.
Yeah.
Maybe we can bring it around any and wrap up.
Yeah, I'd like, sorry, I came here late.
Yes,
this might have been brought up before, but who kind of like, all these different things straddle these different departments, right? In some ways, like, we talk about the learning aspect of it, and that's education. We want to bring arts into the schools and maybe bring more youth into it. But then that becomes this two different, it spreads out enough that both sides can be like, we don't really know how to take this on. And then it even goes like, they have an arts center, they have like, okay, well, what's private, what's people that are making a living off art, and then what people are doing is like sort of a hobbyist thing, or then more like a secondary, almost just like a pastime stuff, like extracurricular. Then we mix all these together, and nobody seems to take responsibility for it. And it's like right now, like what we have, it seems to be more of a crafts focused. Like we got the film commission coming up, and that's done a lot for like the work that I do, people that I work with. But it's like, who's this, you know, to say for an art center, it almost has all these different things because everybody has a vested interest in it, but everybody's bringing all these different things to the table at once. So they almost want to make this thing that it ends up, the ideas become too huge that nobody can end up taking responsibility for it. And nobody can say, well, that can, Aurora College or, you know, or like ITI can be like, well, that'll be our part. We can provide this much. It's like, we almost seem like a group of people that are given some kind of responsibility to create this, but it feels like that there's just too much on the table.
No, I mean, that's where you need a strong plan.
And if you need business people behind you.
Yeah.
Artists aren't always known for their business acumen.
So at the moment, we have something that's
good. Thank goodness.
at the moment, it seems like something between a cross between a jellyfish and an octopus. And like it's about that easy to sort of, yeah, can, you know, try to quantify. Anyone else?
Thank you for your ideas and for your suggestions. There are some new things that have come up today, and thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
No.
Thank you.
And I like the center. I really do. I think
Thanks,
this is a great building.